Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, it was a few years back at one of the large Lutheran churches in Minneapolis that the pastor had gotten up to read the scripture lesson, just like I just read the scripture lesson just now, and he was taking a deep breath before launching into his sermon, when suddenly there was a man, a stranger, in the balcony. And he stood up and he shouted very loudly, "I have a word from the Lord." And everybody, as you can imagine, turned back to the balcony to see who this was. And what do you think he said next? What word from the Lord do you think this man had? Jerry Soholt last night at our 5 o'clock service said, he probably said, "Go Pack, go." And I said, "No, that's not what he said." We don't know what he said, because the ushers scooted up the stairs as fast as they could. They got this man, they kind of walked him down the stairs, and they escorted him out of the church. We don't know what the word of the Lord, the word from the Lord that that man had for that congregation that day. But I think it's a little strange, isn't it, that every week one of us pastors stands up here, we spread out our notes, we kind of clear our throats a little bit, and we start to preach. And what are you expecting on Sunday morning, on the Sabbath day, when the pastor begins to talk? You're expecting a sermon, right? But you know what? Nobody kind of tenses up. I didn't see any heads kind of looking back or looking forward with alarm about what this word from the Lord is going to be. I don't know if anybody's tensing up right now. Are you tensing up about what I might say today? Nobody's head turned in alarm. A few heads might nod off in going to sleep, I know, in a minute, but no ushers are leaping into action because somebody's ready to speak. Instead, what you do is you politely listen, you settle in to hear what the pastor's going to say. What are we expecting on Sunday mornings? A sermon, yes. But how about a word from the Lord? Are you expecting a word from the Lord? Shout it out, a word from the Lord. I hope that you expect, when you come to worship, that you are expecting not just a sermon, but a word from the Lord. A word that might be refreshing to you. A word that might be challenging to you. A word that might just be a little startling from you. A word that comes from Jesus himself. I hope you expect all of the above, but above all, a word that is good news. Good news for you and this world. So what is the word of the Lord for us today? About 2,000 years ago, on a Sabbath day just like today, a local man, Joseph's son, Jesus, he was home for the weekend. He was in Nazareth. He was raised in Nazareth, and he was asked to read the lesson in church and to preach the sermon. And the congregation knew Jesus well. He had been raised there. He was there as a little boy. Some of the men and women, I think, remember driving him to soccer practice with their kids in their minivan. He used to come over and he used to play hide and seek at all the people's houses, or come over and walk for a while on top of the water in the swimming pool, or maybe he turned water into wine at their parties. I don't know what Jesus did as a little boy. I'm just kidding. He probably didn't do that. But he was familiar to them. He was in their homes. He was in his hometown. So he stands up and he reads the scripture lesson, and they're interested. They settle back to see what he's going to say. And what do you think they were expecting? They were expecting a sermon, but what they got instead was a word from the Lord, a word from the Lord. So what was his word, and more importantly, what is Jesus' word for us today? Jesus says this, and this whole episode is recorded in Luke chapter 4. Jesus sets out his mission. He sets out his agenda for what he's going to be about, and listen to what he says. He says, "I have come to bring good news to the poor. I have come to proclaim release to those who are captive. I have come to bring recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free. The poor, the captives, the blind, the oppressed, that's who Jesus has come for. And he closed his Bible and he said, "The word of the Lord." And you know what those people that day, they did not say, "Thanks be to God." You know what they did? They got angry. They got mad. They said, "How in the world could Jesus say he's coming for the poor? How could he say he's coming for the oppressed and for those that are captive? That's not us." And they got mad. And if you read continually in Luke chapter 4, pretty soon they are ready to throw him over the cliff because they did not like this word from the Lord. They expected a sermon with 3 points, a poem, maybe a movie clip, and a conclusion. And what they got instead was a word from the Lord. And they didn't like it. It was startling and shocking to them. Because Jesus says he has come for the least, for the lost, for the forgotten, and for the outcast. He's come for all of us. But he's also come for those who have no voice. We have just come through a rather contentious election cycle in which, at least in part, the poor, the minorities, the immigrants were part of the rhetoric. And some are afraid now that they will be left behind. We certainly hope not, and we'll work that doesn't happen. We'll wait and see. But the good news from Jesus that day, and the good news for us today, is that he is King, is that he is Lord, and that he has come to save each and every one of us. At the foot of the cross, every single one of us are equals. We are all beggars. We are all sinners. We are all in need of a Savior, no matter what. No matter how important we may think we are, or how forgotten we may think we may be, we are all equals at the foot of the cross, all in need of a Savior. And as Jesus saves us, then he changes us, and he empowers us, and he calls us to take up his vision, to take up his agenda, to make sure that the least, the lost, and the poor do not get left behind, but rather they too have good news, the good news of God's salvation in Jesus Christ brought to them in deed and in word. That's what Jesus says in Luke chapter 4. It is his vision, it is his mission, it is his agenda for ministry. And as a church council, and as a pastoral staff and a larger staff, and certainly as a congregation, we strive to make Jesus' agenda and his mission ours. We talk about it a lot in terms of the great commandment to love one another as Jesus has loved us. And in the Great Commission, to go into all nations, baptizing in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, going wide in our outreach so that all would have a living and dynamic relationship with this God who loves them. I don't know about you, but I am so pumped up. I am so excited to be fully staffed here now at Gloria Day. We have great capacity with a full pastoral staff and a full staff team, together with all of you in this growing congregation, to do incredible ministry for Jesus. We have worked hard over these last few years. Call committees, all of you, and your commitment of time and your commitment of volunteering and your financial giving to get to this place. We are running full steam ahead at Gloria Day to do Christ's mission in and around this community and around the world. I've told you this story before, but maybe you've heard about the pastor of a brand new small Baptist church. He's addressing his newly formed congregation, brand new congregation, and he says to them, "In order for this congregation to thrive and do what Jesus is calling us to do, then first, people, we have to learn to crawl." And the people in the Baptist church yelled back, "Crawl, preacher, crawl!" And then after we've learned to crawl, the preacher said, "We've got to get up onto our 2 feet and we've got to learn to walk in the name of Jesus." And they all shouted back, "Walk, preacher, walk!" And after we learn to walk, we've got to hit our full stride and we're going to make a difference in Christ's name and in people's lives, and we're going to be running in the name of Jesus. And they all yell, "Run, preacher, run!" And he continued, "And if we're going to run and do all that the Holy Spirit is calling us to do and to go wide in faith and deep in our outreach," the preacher said, "then we've all got to dig deep and we've got to give generously of our money." To which the people yelled, "Crawl, preacher, crawl." Well, Gloria Day, I want to say to you today, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you very much, because we are indeed running for the sake of the gospel. You are very generous with your finances. You are very generous with your time. You are very generous with your energy, with your volunteering, as this continues to be a community of faith that really is a center for mission for Jesus Christ. I have heard story after story of faith and miracles happening. We witnessed two of them this morning in the Sacrament of Holy Baptism. And now that we are fully staffed, we are going to be able to put even more time and financial resources into the programs and the outreach ministry of this congregation. This is an exciting time for us. I'm so proud of this congregation for its commitment, for example, to help solve the hunger problem in our state and in our country and in our world. And we are ready to do even more. I'm so proud of this congregation for its partnership in places like Pueblo de Dios, a new Latino congregation in downtown Sioux Falls. I'm so pleased with the way in which we work around this city and this community and around the world, even with churches in places like Cameroon in Africa and Nicaragua overseas. And we're ready to do even more of that kind of ministry. Next week, I'm excited to have Pastor Rebel Hurd. She's going to be with us to share what's happening in a new ministry that's going on in our midst here in Sioux Falls with what is being called the Church on the Street. She is an ordained Lutheran pastor. She's called by our Lutheran Synod and ELCA to be doing word and sacrament ministry among the homeless people right here in Sioux Falls. And she's going to be here and share a little bit about her calling and about what's going on. It's just getting started, and it's off to a great start, but we're going to be partnering together with her and that ministry, together with many other congregations in this city, taking our lead from Jesus, who says, "I have come to bring good news to those who are poor." So thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And as we approach next weekend, as I said, we're going to have opportunity to bring our financial pledges, our estimates of giving for 2017, to the altar as an act of worship. And I ask that you pray about that this week as you prepare for worship next week. What is God calling you to give in order to bring the good news of Jesus Christ to people who have not yet heard? And what is God calling you to give so that we together can make a difference in mission and in outreach? People have asked me, I've had people come into the office these last couple weeks since the letters to the congregation have gone out about our stewardship Sunday. They said, "How much should we increase if we're able to increase?" I don't know how to answer that. I just say, well, you go all in. Go all in with Jesus, not just with finances. I say, strive to get to a tithe. If you're not at a tithe yet, strive to get there. The biblical principle for giving. And if you're already there, there are many people in our congregation who are going well beyond a tithe. I just say kind of go all in. God loves a cheerful giver, the Bible says. But it's not just of finances. It's all the time that you give and the volunteering. It is just awesome what's going on in this place. As you know, our youth groups, it's just one example of ministry. They are involved every single week in fellowship events and Bible studies. Our youth group continues to grow. I said a few weeks ago that we now have from preschool to high school 1,000 or more kids that are active in our ministry here at Gloria Day. But one of the things they do in addition to serving around Sioux Falls throughout the year is that they go to the last three summers anyway, to service trips to inner cities, different inner cities across our country. 3 years ago to Virginia, then to San Diego, California, this past summer to Houston, Texas. And they're great trips that help mature our kids' faith as they put their faith in action, in love. And every year it's getting more and more time consuming for our children, youth, and family staff and volunteers to raise the thousands and thousands of dollars that are needed for these trips and for scholarships for some of the kids in our neighborhoods who are not able to afford the cost of those trips. So they work and they work it off to help raise some money. But I want to close today by showing you a portion of a video from last year's trip to Houston. The kids served with an organization that provides shoes for people who don't have shoes. They served in an organization that works with foster kids. They worshiped, played, and prayed with other churches, with other organizations. But before we see the video, I want to tell you that this year, what one of the things that we want to do in increasing, and I want to again say thank you, we are in very fine financial shape at Gloria Day, but we want to increase our children, youth, and family budget by about $20,000 so that our children, youth, and family staff and volunteers are not consumed all the time with fundraising and trying to raise money for that. So we're going to increase in that area, but also in many areas of ministry that provide for the telling of God's word and the sharing it in outreach. One area in which our overall ministry is growing. So take a look at this video. Pray this week about your level of giving as we give glory to God and as we go deep in faith and wide in outreach. Take a look.
What if you could go back and relive one day of your life all over again and unmake the mistake that left you a million miles away from the you you once knew? Now yesterday's shame keeps saying that you'll never get back on track. But what if I told you? You're one step away from surrender, one step away from coming home, coming home. One step from arms wide open, His love has never let you go. Doesn't matter how far you've gone, mercy says you don't have to keep running down the road. You're on, love's never met a lost cause. Your shame, lay it down, leave your ghost in the past, cause you know that you can't go back, but you can turn around. You've never been more than one step away from surrender, one step away from coming home, coming home. Wide open, His love has never let you go. One step away, lay down your old chains. Come now and take up your new name. Your best life up ahead now. You one step away, lay down your old chains. Come now and take up your new name. Your best life up ahead now. You one step away. Come now, take up your new name. Your best life up ahead now. You just one step away.
Jesus said, I have come to bring good news to the poor, recovery of sight to the blind, to set the oppressed free. Really, that's all of us. We are saved by grace, and we are empowered and called to go love in Jesus' name. That's what we're about here at Gloria Day. That's what the Christian church is about all around the world. That is a great word from the Lord today. Amen.